the other day, maybe a year ago, group of my first circle disciples, the people who are with me for last 6-7 years, they all had started having discussion that they wanted to give something for me. 6 hours they discussed, went on and on and on. Something you should give to make Swamiji happy, to please him. They were discussing what to give for my birthday gift, 30th birthday. They went on and for 6 hours. They went on, went over everything. Does he like any food? And the person who gives, cooks for me for last 6-7 years, she says, he never asked any food second time. I don't remember him. I don't remember him mentioning any food and saying, cook that and bring. And they went through some object, either some bed or some cart or some car. And they said, no, nothing, nothing, this sweet or this, that. They went on. They discussed, is Swamiji likes somebody amongst us, some people, is any of us are his favorites? Nothing. They went on and on and on. The discussion for 6 hours. See, people who are living outside, if they can't find out, that is different. But people who are living with me 24 hours, who sees my routine from morning till night, who live around me, who for years, finally they came to me and asked, Swamiji, 6 hours we discussed, we couldn't find single thing to make you happy. But you yourself tell something. Only then we can give that to you. Nothing can be done. I told them, this is freedom. This is freedom. Understand. Just imagine that you don't feel like, see, I am not saying be sterile or dumb or completely disrespectful to others. No. Not that. But you know, suddenly you don't, you are just free. You are just free. When people are there in front of you, you will respond to them completely. Actually, when people are there in front of you, if you respond to them completely, intensely, that moment, you will not carry the hangover about them or the memory of them inside you. When you are physically with them, you always have that feeling, oh, this will be lost in 10 minutes, this person will go away, he may not be with me, she may not be with me. You are half only in the presence. Because half of your being is thinking about the absence. Only half of your being is in the presence. So when they are absent, again half of your being wants their presence. It's a tug of war, constantly fighting. When you are present with them, you are absent. When they are not present in front of you, you want the presence. It goes on. Understand? This is the ultimate freedom. Pratyahara is ultimate freedom which can happen to human beings. Ramakrishna is completely detached from everything. Even detached word is not a right word. Sorry to use that word. Pratyahara means taking your senses away from the objects. Even detachment has a kind of a one line of violence in it. The hatred in it. But here there is no hatred. Neither hatred nor attachment nor love. It's like if a air moves, if a breeze moves from one area to other area, it is not that the breeze is hating that area. No. It just moves. So just moving from your senses is pratyahara. Ramakrishna did not have any problem to do pratyahara. He just moved away from the senses. Then Totaburi says, do dharana now. Means center your whole energy in your consciousness. Now Ramakrishna has a problem. Throughout his life, he worshipped Kali. The moment he is centralizing, is integrating his space, his mind, the Kali is there. He is able to take himself away from everything, but not from the Kali. The Kali is there. He is able to do pratyahara. Everything else is taken away. He is not disturbed. He is not bothered about it. He is a free, liberated person. But the tarana means integrating, centering yourself on your very self. There problem starts. The Kali Murti is there. The Kali is there in his consciousness. Throughout his life, he revered, worshipped, respected. Just holding Kali only, he left everything. Totabri says, no, give up that also. Give up that also. Move away from the Kali's form. Only then you can become enlightened. Understand? He rushes to the temple. He rushes to the temple again. He is asking Kali. This is the beauty. He is asking Kali. Ma, this Nanda. Nanda means naked sadhu. Totaburi is a Naga parampara. Naga parampara. Naga sannyasis don't wear cloth. Only when they enter inside city, they are supposed to wear clothes. Paramahamsas, the whole sky is their cloth. They are supposed to wear cloth only when they enter a city or civilization to teach or to share some truths. The place where Ramakrishna was staying, it's a temple garden, and there is one space, one part allotted by the Nagas, allotted for Nagas. Those Nagas will come and stay there. They will live a naked life. They will just like a childlike life they will live, and they won't wear clothes, they won't eat as we eat, as the normal people eat. They may take some little food, they will just burn that food and inhale, just inhale, that's all, nothing much. So they live different kind of a life. So he goes and asks Kali, this Nanda is saying that I should go beyond you. Just Kali smiles and says, yes, listen to what he says. Listen to what he says. She gives the technique. Visualize my sword as your intelligence and cut my form. Please understand, if you are intense to any practice, even if it is wrong practice, the practice itself will lead you to the ultimate practice. Here he is intensely connected to Kali. She is guiding him. Because when you are intensely connected to any practice, your own self appears on the other side and continues to guide. Intensity is essence of everything. The whole story. So beautiful. You see, when he fell in love with a deity, with an idol, any intelligent man, what he will tell? Sitting with this idol, playing with these deities, what foolish thing. Better he could have been meditating on the whole cosmos, the formless energy. See, the people who go on talking about formless God, formless energy, even they will be visualizing some big beach or a sky. Even that is a form. They don't understand. In a subtle way, even that is a form. So, I have seen many intellectuals, especially these great Vedantins. The great Vedantins who are responsible for all the damage. Sorry for the truth, but what I said is true. They go on saying that these things are all not necessary, the deities are not necessary, you don't need to connect with the deities and they won't lead you to enlightenment. They will lead only to savigalpa samadhi, means samadhi with one form. You will be disconnected from all forms, but you will be merged in one form, you will not achieve ultimate enlightenment. Here is the story, proof. Even if you are connected to deity, you can achieve nirvipa samadhi, the ultimate enlightenment. And she says, go and listen to what he says. Use this sword and cut my form. And Ramakrishna gathers courage and visualizes the sword as a knowledge and cuts the form of the Devi. Enters into enlightenment, samadhi. Understand, when he started, it's very crude practice. Just sitting in front of a deity, ringing bell whole day, it looks very ordinary. But his intensity, his intensity led him to enlightenment. Please understand, what you are doing, you don't have to bother at all. All you need is abhyasa vairagya abhyam tad nirodaha. Abhyasa and vairagya. There is one more beautiful story. Because again and again my teacher used to talk about this sutra, this sloka. I have so many stories about this sutra. One guy wanted to have a master, a guru, and achieve enlightenment. He went round. He was not able to find any guru, or he did not feel connected to any guru. Somehow he was never able to feel connected. He went on judging. The big problem is, when you start seeking guru, you have your own ideas. You take that frame and try to put with everybody. Will that frame fits? The big problem is, with our original guru, your frame will never fit. You will never be able to fit your frame with a living master. You will be like just like a fluid, liquid, river. Not even river, you will make a breeze. Even river, you can fix your frame. It will be like a breeze, nothing will fit. Many times I have seen these intellectuals, these pandits, they hear so many things about me. It really happened just few years before. Those days my photograph was not very popular. One guy, highly intellectual, maybe 80 years old, well read, he heard about me and he came to the ashram, wanted to meet me. Outside the ashram there is a big rock. If you have come to the ashram you would have seen a big rock. I was sitting on that rock, shaking my leg, and nobody was with me. I was just sitting in the evening time, alone, and playing with the stones which are around. This guy came and asked me, I wanted to meet Swamiji. I told him, go to the meditation hall, he will come in half an hour. Now he went and sat there, and I was feeling too lazy to go and sit and meet with him. Anyhow, I said, all right, I have to meet. He has come from all the way. And I went and prepared myself, had all my vibhuti and kumkum and put on my rudraksha, that regular systematic, all that things. I went to the hall and I was about to sit in the throne. I was about to sit in the seat, usually where the classes are conducted or darshan is given. I was about to sit. He suddenly got up and he said, no, I want to meet Big Swamiji. Now I am in a trouble. And there was nobody around me also. So I very politely said, I am the Pitadipati, I am the Swami in this ashram. He said, no, I want to meet your Guruji, Big Swamiji, who has healed my cousin. Then I told that person who got healed. Actually, his cousin got healed, he was in coma and he got healed and he became all right. I told that person's name and I said, you are talking about that person only. He said, yes, I am talking about that person only. I am the person who healed. Sorry to tell, usually Swamis, we don't carry ID cards. Anyhow, there was one small book there. I took out that book and showed, see, this photograph. Below you see, the name is written Nithyananda. And you heard the name already, Nithyananda, na? He said, yes. See the photograph? I am the person. I want you to know the important truth. That fellow did not talk to me. He went away. He said, no. He just went away. he can't understand, he can't think, he can't relate. Somebody young can be a Swami or can be a master, can be a teacher. It's very difficult. They have their own frame. They have their own frame. We just go and try to put that frame and see. Especially a logical mentality which believes only through senses knowledge can be received. See, there are different pramanas. The pramana, first pramana is pratyaksha, what you receive through eyes or listening or through the senses. Second pramana is inference, pratyaksha, anumana, second pramana. What you received, with that you do anumana, means infer. You yourself try to grind and churn and do the process and come up, cook the things and come up, inference. The civilizations which believes only in these two, pratyaksha and anumana, can never imagine the agama, the third part, or intelligence, enlightenment, knowledge can happen in a very young age. That's a big problem. That's a big problem. So you have your own frame. These guys go on, try to put that frame. And when it doesn't work, they say, no, we are not able to find gurus, we are not able to find these, we are not able to find that. They have their own stories. Many people come and tell me, I am a sincere seeker, but I am not able to find a single guru. Please understand, if you are a seeker, beautifully Mahavira says, the God sends your master, only then puts the fire inside you. If you are feeling the fire, be very clear, already your master is here. He is already here. God never puts the fire, then sends the master. No. He sends the master and puts the fire. This guy was trying to find out a master. Somehow he was not able to. He tried for 12 years. 12 years is too much. Too much. Finally, he is depressed, discouraged completely. He decides, I have decided that God is going to be the only source of inspiration, and I will accept the first person who comes in this road as my guru and do what he says. He is very strong in his decision. He sits in the forest road, he sits in one road and he decides, first person who comes in this way will be my guru, his instruction I will follow. And unfortunately, one thief was running through that road after stealing. He just now robbed the palace and he is running through that road trying to escape. This fellow fell at his feet and caught hold of his feet. Caught hold of the thief and he said, oh my master, bless me, give me liberation, enlighten me. And the thief is saying, "Arey, I am a thief, leave me. Don't you see, I just now robbed. And police is chasing me, leave me." And this guy says, no, you are my master, teach me something and go. This guy says, what is this, what to do? I am in a big mess.